Go ahead and get started for you guys that are out in the narthex. If you want to come on in, that would be great. They're having too much fun out there. So, well, good morning. It is great to see you folks. We have a chance to have yet again another week to start off with God's grace and the gift of life and health and strength and faith to be able to celebrate all those things together today. Why don't we acknowledge those blessings from the Lord with our responsory together from Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Well, let's begin then worshiping our Lord in the name of our God that we are here to serve together, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Come on up, darling. It's the time. Glad to have a chance to see and visit with everybody together, but we do have to go ahead and we'll have you come on up, hon. We'll go ahead and start singing here. So we're going to start off with the song Evidence, being able to rejoice that God is present everywhere and we get to see his action so often and how he cares for us and provides for everything. And we just praise him rightfully together again today for all of his mercies and provision. So let's sing Evidence.
All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Help me remember when I'm weak, fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory. You are my strength, and you always will be. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. See the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sins rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. I see the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sins rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. Oh, I see the evidence of your goodness all my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Should I fear, the evidence is here. Why should I fear?
God shows himself over and over in life and provides for us and helps us each day, one day at a time. Why don't we stand then? Let's sing our second song of praise to our Lord. Very similar thoughts, very different format. What a friend we have in Jesus. Celebrating that when God is all evidenced around us, that it's for good. You know, he could be a God that said, I'm just going to play with you. I'm just going to see how much I can make you suffer and squirm just because I can. That's what a lot of people think God is like. But the real God, the living God, is not. He loves us with an everlasting love. He's the one that says, talk to me, come be with me, and I will be there for and with you. So let's celebrate that reality with what a friend we have in Jesus. Hang on just a second. Let me make sure I got the page. There we go. Okay.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we offer.
Isn't it, to take everything to the Lord, including our weaknesses? You know how it is, don't you? If you start telling somebody all your weaknesses, you start thinking, oh no, now they know all my downside and dirt side, and now they can use it to lay against me later on and be able to stand on top and say, I'm better than you. So sometimes we're afraid to tell our weaknesses to people, and we can be afraid to tell it to God too. God is not like people. Of course, God says, I know everything about you. He says, talk to me. He says, I am your Savior, and that's why I came, is you need it. That's for all of us. Every one of us needs a Savior desperately. So let's, with humility and trust in him, let's ask him for forgiveness for all of our sins, shortcomings, and weaknesses, and thank the Lord then together for that grace that we all do need. We pray together. Heavenly Father, I am thankful to belong to you, to have you as my God, and me being your child. Forgive me for the times that I forget or refuse to trust you, sometimes living as if I don't really think that you will be there to help and guide me daily. I ask your special mercy and help in conquering the following areas of my life where I know I am in need of repentance and a fresh start. Let's continue then together. Forgive us, dear Father, for Jesus' sake. Thank you for revealing him as our true Savior. We trust in him alone for forgiveness and mercy. Turn our hearts toward you more and more as time goes forward. Help us, Holy Spirit, to delight ourselves in the Lord, to have thankful, joyful hearts, to never quit growing in faith, and to welcome your changes in our hearts and lives for good. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Remember that Jesus said that a doctor doesn't come to somebody who's all healthy and doesn't need him. A doctor comes to somebody who's sick and need healing. We don't come to Jesus and say, Jesus, I did a great job of being so holy and righteous. Aren't you proud of me? Jesus says, come to me, you are weak and weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, including our sins, because he is the one, the only one, that can lift that burden off of our shoulders and cast it as far as the east is from the west. So rejoice with me, he has forgiven our sins. He is our Savior, and we are his adopted family, each one of us. And we rejoice in that, have a seat then in that peace that only he can give. And let's continue to say, Lord, teach us from your word and help us to really have that peace and joy that you would love for us to receive as your gift. Let's take a look at the word of the Lord here first off from John chapter 15 today, starting with verse 1. That's on page 1676 in the Pew Bibles if you want to grab that. You want to look along in your own Bible, that's always better. Yeah, I encourage you, bring your own Bible and mark it up and put things in there that you can say, I want to remember that. That's a good tool that God gives us. It's like our tools in our tool kits, if they're just all squeaky clean and never used, they're pretty, but they're not a whole lot of help, are they? You don't want a pretty Bible that never gets used. You want to have it be something you use and have it be a great gift God gives to strengthen our faith and our trust in him. So today, chapter 15 of John, starting with verse 1, this is very well fitting in with our parable of the sower that we're looking at in this fall series and how we want to grow, we want to thrive. Jesus reminds us, it's not going to happen unless it's from being connected to me. And I am the one, the only one, that will be able to supply that growth and that health. So let's rejoice in that in this reading. Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. And that's how far we'll get in the first reading from God's word. Coming around, okay. Let's join in praising our Lord together with our next song. That's one that we learned not too long back this summer called Famous For, asking that God would supply. This is he's famous for his help and deliverance of all different struggles and strains over life. We ask him to help us with the things that we're dealing with in our own lives, in our country, in our world, that God would do what he is famous for. So let's sing that song of prayer to our Lord, and that basically stating our trust in him to still be God, to still help us in the world. We still need him every bit as much as ever.
Amen. There is no doubt, because I have seen your faithfulness. My fortress over and over. I have a hope found in your name. I have a strength found in your grace, your faithfulness. My fortress over and over. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions. Bring dry bones to life and do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. I believe in you. God, I believe in you. Release your love inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us. Over and over. On our own. Make way through the waters. Walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions. Bring dry bones to life and do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable. All things are possible in you. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable. All things are possible in you. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions. Bring dry bones to life. And do what you are famous for. What you are famous for. I believe in you. I believe in you. There is no fear. Cause I believe. There is no doubt, cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over.
So thankful. He is a faithful God. You can count on him generation to generation, now and forevermore. All right, let's take a look at the second part then of experiencing God and his word. We're going to continue as we've been doing this fall series on the sower and the seed parable. Today we're going to be looking at the fourth of the different responses to the seed being sown. We saw the first three earlier, and they all had good intentions, but they ended up in the end not bearing fruit. Why does the farmer sow the seed to be able to say, well, that's a pretty little leaf that you have? You know, maybe now we grow plants just to be pretty. But a farmer plants a seed to have it bear fruit. And the first three ended up not doing that. So today, though, we get to see the one that bears the fruit, the one that does end up becoming what God had designed it, intended to be. That's exciting, being able to look at having fruitful living for us as God's people who respond to his word in ways that allow us to bear the fruit that will last, as the Lord promises he will do in us and through us. And it's looking at being able to get a good return on the investment. You know, God invests a lot in us. He wants us to rejoice with him in heaven forever, but he also wants us to be helpful while we're here in the world. So it makes sense. We're used to that, aren't we? Thinking about, where can I find a good return on my investment? You know, people that are good at investing in stocks and bonds and things, they know how to find a good investment. I know it's kind of funny as I think about it. Back years ago, y'all who know what Thrivent is, of course, Thrivent, the action teams and things we have now, way back when I was young, and they were still called Aid Association for Lutherans, and they had a new policy plan out for life insurance that you could be able to get not only the insurance, but also build some value besides as you paid your monthly part to it. And it worked out pretty good because they said, well, if you do this, then you will gain for your investment. And there was, that was back in the times when 7, 8, 9, 10% interest was pretty normal. Of course, you're paying out that too on things, but you could get that kind of return for your investments. And they said, well, now we won't tell you. They said, we're gonna guarantee to you that it will never go below 4%. Oh, ha, 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 they said, that would never happen to have that terrible low amount to return. 4% would be like being broke pretty much in your investments. But just so that you know, it'll never get lower than 4%. Of course, now when you want to invest in CD or money market, you're lucky if you get 1%. And they have to guarantee that 4%. They're like saying, surely you want to cash that in, Mr. Pummel. You don't want to keep that anymore, do you? They don't want to keep that policy because that still is allowing us to still have 4% coming back on that money instead of 1 or 1.5%. So it's funny, isn't it, how returns and investments vary back and forth. I did find this last week, this blew my mind. I found a place, I'd encourage you to consider checking into this too, where you can get a return investment in the 500+%. Have you ever found something like that? I haven't. It may exist, but I don't know where it is until last week. 500, this one particularly, is a 540% return on the investment. Yes! Can't wait. All right, because I love you, I'm not going to even charge you for big money. I'm going to let you in on this secret. 540% or more. My dear darling wife prepared corn the cob for us this past week. Pulling all the shucks off and taking a look at that, it's like, whoa, look at all those corn kernels, which are seeds, right? How many seeds did it take to produce this ear of corn? Just one of its parents, right? All it took, one seed, plant in the ground, grows. Pretty soon you got the stalk, pretty soon you got the ears. And this particular one, this is the only further I've cared to try to count up. It's 30 kernels long, 18 kernels around, add that all up, 540 kernels approximately on this one ear alone. That's a decent return, isn't it? When a farmer can get that kind of return, you can see why they say, wow, praise God. And that's just for one. Of course, there's multiple thousands of seeds that each corn individual seed, when planted and grows and comes to fruitfulness, will produce. See, God knows, you know, a lot of us now are not farmers, so we don't understand those things as well. But when God spoke the words of the parables, it was a farming community, and everybody understood that a seed is a great return when it gets to its fruitful stage. So he uses that to help us to think about when it comes to our relationship with the Lord, and what is his purpose for creating us to begin with, and bringing us and giving us life by his holy word, being able to give us the joy of being alive in Christ, and being able to be the results that he would have for us. He wants us to be alive, to grow, to be able to bear fruit. As he says at John 15:16, that I've given you, called you to be my own, that you may bear fruit that will last. Not just stuff for this life, which is all going to fade away sooner or later. The only thing that's going to last forever is the souls of people. And this is where he says, I want you to bear that fruit as you live in this world. So let's take a look at this fourth of the seeds in the parable of the sower. It's Luke chapter 8, page 1606 in the Pew Bibles. If you grab your own Bible, let's look. We're going to look at verse 15. Luke 8, verse 15. Jesus says, the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart, who hear the word, who retain it, and by persevering produce a crop. This is the goal of all the seeds that were planted. Only the one out of the four that he's talking about reached it, but it's reason to celebrate. It's a good thing to finally be where you're bearing fruit as a seed. It's true for us as God's people, bearing fruit that will last. It's a good thing, too, that we want. Let's break it down a little bit and see what he's talking about here. You see, the good soil is those that have a noble and good heart. Those who say, you know what? I want what God wants. I want to be able to follow His heart, His noble heart, His way of thinking. It's almost like I want to be bolted on my heart to the Lord's. You know, bolts are cool because they can tighten things very secure, and they don't come off, then they stay stuck where they're supposed to. I think about that on wheels of our vehicles. Your wheel is bolted to your car. The intention of that is when your car turns to the right, the wheel goes with it. Turns to the left, the wheel goes with it. The car stops, the wheel stops. The car goes like fast and furious. Then the wheel stays with it too. I know somebody who actually had where that didn't work one time. You ever had that happen? Where one of your bolts on your wheels decided, I'm done, and quit? And the wheel said, wee, I'm off on my own now. Not a good day. Not a good day for the wheel, not a good day for the car or the driver. Thank God the person was spared and didn't get hurt. But gosh, I hope that never happens to me. So being bolted securely to something is a good thing when you want it to stay secure. That's what God says. This is a blessing. You and I stay bolted to the heart of God, saying, God, teach my heart to think like you. Teach my body and my mouth and my priorities to function like you. Help me to love like you do. Help me to want what is good and right and holy and noble like you do, and not follow off into the ways of the world around me and leave you at the side of the road. So to be able to have that fruitfulness is staying connected to the heart of God, but also being able to hear the word and to retain it, being able to be those who have that seed of God's word growing in our hearts and cherished and held on to, being able to be those who are by the nature not only like a being bolted to the heart of God, but also being like a pipeline connected to God's heart. You know, pipes are a good thing too, aren't they? I'm so glad we have pipes that bring the water from the water towers down to our house. Had it one time where that pipe broke, the pipe running between our meter out by the road and where it goes into the house, water was pouring up everywhere. We had almost no pressure in the house. It was awful. You know, if you don't have a pipe working right, you don't get the stuff you need and pump through it. Not a good day. And God uses that picture for us to think about our lives as fruitful servants of His. It's never intended to just be, I love you, I bless you, so you can just sit there and hold it all for yourself. I want you to be a pipeline as I supply for you. Also let that flow through to bless those in your life. And it's something that is a real gift God allows us to have and to share. To be able to have those who let the water of life, which is Jesus and His Holy Spirit, flow through us to impact and to help the people around us. That's a good thing. It's the intention for God. It's what He's talking about with being fruitful. And here again, reading this through, it just shows, I guess, my ignorance about farming and gardening and stuff. When you think about something that's a fruitful seed, what comes to mind, pictured in your mind? When I think about fruitful seeds, I think about, well, there's seeds in oranges, there's seeds in grapes, there's seeds in apples, you know, fruit. And when I think about fruit and seeds, what do I do with the seeds of oranges? I don't think about the fruits of the seeds of oranges being something to plant. I get them out of the way because I want to just eat the fruit. And maybe sometimes because a lot of us are not involved in farming, that might be what we think of. We think about fruitfulness. Fruitfulness is, wow, this is good fruit. I get to eat it. It makes me grow and be healthy and strong and all. It takes care of me. And we may misunderstand when we read Jesus saying, I want you to be fruitful, that our world says, well, yes, be fruitful. Have all kind of things growing and good in your life. Be better off than you were last week or last year. Oh, that's a good thing to be better off, isn't it? When God talks about the word fruitful, I didn't know this until checking this out for this week. You go back and you look in the scriptures. when God talks about being fruitful over and over and over again, he doesn't say be fruitful like a grape and eat it and be healthier and stronger. His determination of when something is fruitful comes along with the line of Genesis 1, the first place you see in the Bible, where God says to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply. And over again, when you see the word fruitful in the scriptures used, that's what it's referring to. Not, I'm stronger now, I'm bigger now, I'm tougher now, but rather, I'm multiplying. And this is where God says, I want you to be fruitful. Growth in my spirit, in your heart, is to be those who are multiplying, people who know Jesus Christ, who have the forgiveness for their sins by Jesus shedding his blood for them and them having faith and receiving it, to be alive in the Lord and growing themselves, to get to that point where they in turn are bearing fruit, helping others that they know to come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord. And that's a whole different way of thinking about fruitfulness than I guess my mind was thinking. So that's a pretty profound thing that we say, Lord, help me to take stock in my blessing of being able to be a pipeline of your word and your love to people to know who you are, that you would bring them to faith in you as well and multiply the people that know Jesus Christ as their Savior. So they'll be with us in heaven one day. That's what God wants. He wants you there, he wants me there, and he wants them there too. And they'll need that faith and trust in him if they're going to be there. So being able to be those who hear the word and retain it. And he says being persevering in order to produce a crop. A crop that can be all different sizes. In Mark chapter 4, the account of the parable, Jesus talks about being some will produce 30 times more than one seed, some will be 60 times more than seed, some will be 100 times the one seed. And God says, all right, ready, set, go. Let's see which one of you can do the best so we can brag about you, and which one's going to be the low number. I'm going to say, oh, I'm so ashamed of you. Is that what the Lord's talking about, some 30, 60, 100? No. Our sinful nature wants to turn everything into a competition that says, I'm better than you are. That is not what God's talking about when he says there will be some 30, some 60, some 100, the different responses and fruitfulness. It's that each individual one will do according to their abilities, to their circumstances, to what's going on, to what God works through them. There will be some who will be thankful that there will be one or two people in their whole life that come to know Jesus Christ and will be in heaven. There will be others who will be touched by a person, thousands, that will come to faith and be saved. God says, don't sit there and compete and say, oh, you're good because you got at least 50, if not more. But say, Lord, who is in my life that I can have an influence on by your spirit working through me? Help me to love them. Help me to teach your word by how I live as well as what I say. Pray for those people. Now, the good thing is that, you know, when you want to bring somebody to faith, all you got to do is just snap your fingers three times, and they'll become a Christian. Isn't that cool? Fast and easy, just about as good as a microwave dinner, right? When's the last time that happened in your life? You were sharing Jesus with somebody and said, oh, I love it. Let's talk for 6 hours. Tell me all about it. And then I'm coming to church with you and Bible class as well. And, by the way, can I serve on one of the food committees at the church too? Yeah, please tell me who that person is and how it worked. That'd be really neat, wouldn't it? Most of the time it doesn't work that way, does it? It takes persistence and perseverance, being able to be faithful and calm and continuing in sharing the word and the actions that back it up. This is the same thing with farming. Farming takes a long time to get to the point where it bears fruit and is able to be harvested. I've seen it living in the farming community. It's hard work, takes a long time, a lot of risk. But man, is it worth it. And this is true when it comes to our souls and the souls of those around us. It's worth it to pursue and persevere in sharing Jesus Christ with those around us in the world. It's something we want to take stock in and think about too. This is a privilege. the joy, as we talk about, the joy of fruitful living, multiplying people who know Jesus and are headed to heaven. If you turn with me over to Philippians chapter 1, God addresses this too, the tension that we live in, the thought of, it takes a lot of hard work to persevere and to be multiplying the fruits of God's work in the lives of people knowing Him. I just want to be in heaven. You ever felt like that? I just want to go home. I know what the Bible talks about, how awesome heaven is going to be, and that's where I want to be. And I wake up and I say, okay, maybe today is the day that I'll die in my sleep. And I open my eyes up, I'll say, there's Jesus, awesome. It may happen. But what if you wake up and you open your eyes and you see the ceiling in your bedroom? You think, oh, another day. Now, part of us says, oh, no, another day. It's going to be so hard living in this world. I don't want to be here. You ever felt like that? Sometimes I do. But God ministers to our spirits with this word from Philippians chapter 1, and we deal with that, the thought of, I don't want to be here and be fruitful. I want to be home in heaven. But look at what he says, Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. That's on page 1826 in the Pew Bibles. Philippians 1, 21. Here, Paul speaking by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is thinking about this. You imagine somebody who might have been kind of tired of life in this world, where Paul was one who'd been beaten for Christ, imprisoned for Christ, mocked for Christ, had to work three times as hard as most people did in order to serve the Lord the way he was, gone all the time from where he was used to his comfortable setting, traveling and such. I could see he'd be saying, man, Lord, just take me home. But he's thinking about this. He's thinking, should I go home? Should I be with the Lord? And he's reflecting on this by the Spirit. He says, for to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. How many times does that happen in life where you win either way, whether you live or you die? Usually we don't think of dying as a good thing, do we? It's like that means you're the loser if you're in a fight to the death. But when it comes to dying in the Lord, it is a blessing to be able to gain eternal life with the Lord, finally seeing it and experiencing it firsthand and forever. But, he says, to me, to live is Christ. If I'm still waking up, my eyes see the ceiling in my bedroom, and I've got another day here to deal with, then this is something that God has given to me with Christ being right here with me every breath and every step of the way. You're still a winner because you belong to Jesus Christ, who's bought you with his blood and promises you, I will be with you. And we want to think about the gain and the benefit of waking up and still having your eyes see the ceiling of your bedroom. That you're not dead in your sleep and you're still here. He starts to reflect on this in the following verses. So he says, verse 22, if I am to go on living in the body, this will mean, wait, let me get that right. Yeah. This will mean fruitful labor for me. See, and there's that reminder. If I have life today, God has a reason for it. You're not just sitting here watching the calendar saying, man, I'm wasting all this time. I should be in heaven. If you're still here, it's because God says, I've got fruitful labor intended for you. People, souls, eternal souls, that will benefit from you still being around. That's kind of a neat thought, isn't it? That God has people who will be blessed because I'm still here. I woke up and I haven't died and gone to heaven yet. So he reflects on this. He says, if I'm to go on living, it means fruitful labor for me. But what shall I choose? I don't know. I am torn between the two. For I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. So it's okay to say, if this is the last day of my life, I'm going to be celebrating at the end of this day. I'm going to be in heaven with the Lord, with all the loved ones that have gone before me into heaven. I'm going to get to see them again. I've been looking forward to that for a long time. It's a good thing to die to be with the Lord. We want to remember, if God doesn't take you home at this day, that's also a good thing. And that's what he goes on. He says, so it's better by far to be in heaven with the Lord. But, verse 24, it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. We don't want to say, Lord, please let me stay here forever because I love this place so much and I don't want to be in heaven with you. That's not what we're talking about. I want to celebrate heaven life here. It's, Lord, I want to stay here if there are people it's more necessary for that I'm not in heaven yet. More fruitfulness, multiplying people knowing Jesus is why I'm still here. And God says to Paul, that's what's going on for you. You will remain in the body. So verse 25, he says, convinced of this, I know I will remain and will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your joy in Christ Jesus will overflow on account of me. Being able to be here still another day, another stretch, things they have to fight with and struggle with. Yeah, it's hard living here, isn't it? Heaven's going to be better by far. He's the first one to say so. But if we're not there yet, not today, then we can also celebrate. I've still got fruitful living to get to do. And remember, when you breathe your last breath in this life, the Lord takes your soul to heaven. You're going to be dancing on cloud nine forever. You're going to have a great life forever. Do you know what you can't do in heaven? You will never in heaven again be able to share and witness to Jesus Christ as someone who doesn't know and trust in him. Once you're in heaven, you don't have time in this world to affect people's eternal souls anymore. That's a loss of a strong ability that God gives us while we're here. So if we can keep that in mind and say, you know, Lord, I want to be in heaven. It's going to be so much better. But if you give me today, and I can be able in some way help and encourage somebody to grow in their faith and stay focused in the Lord, or come to faith and be added to your kingdom people headed to heaven, then that's a good thing. We say, Lord, keep my heart focused on the joy of that fruitful living. Not, I had a great time today because everything went wonderful for me. People all loved me, and I was showing how strong and capable I was. And that's not what we're here for. We're thankful for those blessings we receive as we do. But say, Lord, help me to value today, as long as I've got it, as a way of being able to speak of you to those around, to be part of a church family that intentionally gathers and strengthens and helps each other and studies the word of the Lord together and serves the community in Jesus' name and has an opportunity to affect people for the Lord while we're here. These are good things. And we say, God, help me to cherish it, make good use of it. I know it's going fast. Not all of us will get to be 102 years old like our sweetheart here. If we get 102 years old, yes, I've been able to serve the Lord here for a long time. It may not be all of us, so just cherish today as God gives it. Say, Lord, what would you have me do in being fruitful in your hands? And we pray for this for us all then, in his holy name. Amen. Shall we stand and let's come to our Lord in prayer together. Dear Heavenly Father, we do in this day thank you for the gift you give to us of life twice, not only our physical life and our being made in your image, eternal soul as human beings, but also that second birth by your Holy Spirit coming and creating saving faith in our hearts. Thank you that you've nourished our souls to be at this point today where we know you, trust you, have grown in the faith, and want to continue to grow. Help us to continue to see how you would have us be fruitful in your hands, to intentionally help and strengthen others to know you as the Lord better, or to come to faith and know you and be headed towards heaven along with us. We pray then that you'll help us individually as we live our life day to day to bear witness by our words and deeds. Help us as a church family to work together to further your kingdom by helping people know and trust in you and hear your word. We know, Lord, that it won't happen unless it's by your bringing a person to faith. So we don't suppose that we can somehow, by being so smart or capable, get somebody to become alive in the Christ. We know it's got to be your gift. So But if you have us be a pipeline that would bring your blessings to others and plant those seeds of your word, then help us to do so with joy while we can, while we're here, while we have the opportunity. We pray for your healing and your help, dear Lord, for all who are facing hardships and struggles in all the different forms that they take. We have some specific prayers today also in Jesus' name. We pray for your comfort for Merlin Lind and his family as his brother Gary this past week passed away after being hospitalized with COVID and other health problems. We pray, dear Lord, for your strength for them as they say goodbye to Gary for now and look forward to seeing him again when their work on earth is done and you take them home to heaven as well. We pray that you will continue to grant your healing to Joanne Gibson as she recovers from her knee replacement surgery. Thank you for the healing you've granted to her thus far. Lord, as we were here and thinking about it, talking about it earlier, that you have blessed Alice Yonke with 102 years of life in this world by tomorrow. We thank you for that. Pray that you will continue to bless her and watch over her day to day as she continues to bear fruit for you and to your glory as you give her life and time in this world. Be with her family as well as they celebrate this longevity together. We pray, dear Lord, for your help for Brenda's sister-in-law, Arlene Yonke, and Alice's daughter-in-law, as she's been hospitalized once again, fighting some health issues. Care for her. Please be with Midge Anderson, former member of our church that fell and got banged up a bit this weekend, but thank you for sparing her from breaking anything. We pray, dear Lord, that you continue to grant your help for dealing with COVID and all of its fallout and struggles that it's created in the world, your help for our nation with all the very important issues that it's facing and the different directions that folks would go with it, whether along your ways or away from your ways. We pray for your help for our nation as well. We pray for these things then and so many other things that are all swirling around in our hearts today. We pray them all. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, he who has taught us to pray together, our Father. In heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's wrap up together with our Culture of Peace pledge on the back of your bulletins as we try to do this once each month as a reminder to us. We want to be a people who lives out the difference in Christ that he allows us to and how we interact with people, how our spirits are, to do so in a way that glorifies the Lord and is able to end up being a blessing for us and that person that we're dealing with. So let's speak together the Culture of Peace pledge. As people reconciled to God by the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we believe that we are called to live in and proclaim the peace of Jesus Christ at all levels. We acknowledge that peacemaking consists of both godly attitudes and actions and ask for the Spirit's help to grow in and maintain them both. When conflict emerges, we commit ourselves to respond using the 4 G's of peacemaking, to glorify God, get the log out of your own eye, to gently restore, to go and be reconciled. By God's grace, we affirm our desire for a culture of peace based on love for the Lord, love for people, and love for witnessing to the power of the gospel. We pledge ourselves to strive for this noble goal in our families, at our work, in our community, and in our church. May God help us to practice what we now profess. Amen. Well, this is the week the Lord has made, so let us rejoice in it and make it count for him. The Lord then bless and keep you. Lord, make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Lord, look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Have a terrific week in the Lord then, and I hope to see you then next Sunday. I'm not a warrior, I'm too afraid to lose. I feel unqualified for what you're calling me to.
strength. I got no excuse, 'cause broken people are exactly who you use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. You took a shepherd boy and made him a king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, 'cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, claiming your victory. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me